Check, check, check.
Yeah. Yeah, backwards. Oops.
Yeah, I hear you in my left ear. Or I hear me and more towards the left and you more towards the right.
Seems appropriate.
Which is how... So I was very disappointed.
Yeah?
Because I had... My Antifa Super Soldier serum wasn't delivered until Saturday morning.
Oh.
And they tried to deliver it to my office.
Oh, that was wrong.
And it was signature required, and I wasn't there.
Oh,
so it got bounced back to George Soros.
Oh, well, you know, he'll probably make up for it.
So I just, you know, I was going to just pound a couple of Red Bulls and hope for the best, but it's just not the same.
Not the same, no.
Yeah, so... Meanwhile, when the soldiers showed up at our door, mm-hmm. we discovered that, you know, if you offer them, you know, coffee, toast, and scrambled eggs, they'll come in and they'll hardly even behead you at all.
Yeah, they will just sit down and talk.
Yeah.
That was weird.
They were very nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, we've had a kind of a miserable weekend.
Well, it's miserable on the one hand and glorious.
Glorious to,
on the other.
To waste a couple of days doing very little.
Like almost nothing. Yeah.
It's been not really cold, but just very just dark and rainy.
Dark and rainy, yeah.
And like rained a lot.
Yeah.
And is still raining.
Mm-hmm. Raining now as we speak.
Yeah. So not that fun. What that really means for us, Grace and I would make good use of a quiet rainy weekend.
Yeah.
But what it means for the kids is if they don't get like
get to
2 hours of hard exercise every day,
they're berserk.
They're like literally will be running in circles screaming trying to burn off their excess
energy.
Child energy.
Well, yeah. Like making up fights to have with each other, you know.
Yeah, yeah, it's like They get into wrestling matches instead of just like running around sword fighting.
Right. Well, no, and
like normal kids,
like binging on television, like just staying up. They're not tired enough.
Yeah.
To really go ahead and fall asleep.
Yeah, they stay up half the night. They keep us up half the night because they won't lie down and sleep. They'll get back up and turn the TV on.
Right. No, it's hard for it to get through a rainy day.
Tell us how many years you've been listening to the Power Rangers theme music.
20 years. 20 years I've been listening to this show. It's so bad.
The kid's cousin was visiting with us, and he's a Power Rangers fan. Diehard Power Rangers fan.
Right.
And so we were watching Power Rangers, and the kids have just been, oh, Power Rangers
That's
exist.
Right, we have
That's
that.
Right. We have these Power Rangers DVDs, so they've been watching those all weekend. Like, just make it stop.
Make
it is
stop.
Literally the worst.
It's
oh
the
my
worst
god.
Show. The plot is terrible. The acting is terrible. The music is terrible. The sets are terrible.
It's utterly laughable, but yet kids are transfixed.
And they love this show.
And I guess I'm thinking back, we're trying to like, why do kids love it so much? The show that I loved so much was Land of the Lost.
Oh, and that's kind of trash.
Of course, it's really cheesy.
Yeah.
The only big advantage Land of the Lost had is it actually had screenplays by some pretty big luminaries in science fiction.
Oh, yeah. There were some good stories.
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah. Although, you know, the acting was laughable. The sets mm-hmm. were laughable. The animated dinosaurs were laughable.
Ridiculous.
But what I really loved about Land of the Lost is the science fiction world building.
That was fun.
This premise that somewhere there's a bubble universe that has all these weird...
Weird freaky things.
Weird freaky things with aliens and glowing
Maybe
stones.
Maybe kind of sort of connected to our universe.
Yeah, you know, like it's... you can travel entirely around from one side to the other. You keep going in one direction. You wind up looking at the back of your own head. And
you know what my guilty pleasure was at that age?
What?
Maybe a little bit younger, like 8.
Yeah.
Scooby-Doo. There's no reason to like Scooby-Doo.
Oh, God.
There's no reason to like that
I
show.
Never liked Scooby-Doo. It's just awful. Every show was exactly the same.
Yeah. I like consistency.
I would have gotten away with it too if not for you meddling kids.
Yeah.
No, after the third or fourth plot that's like exactly the same, it's just like,
this is dumb.
This is dumb. My only real factoid about Scooby-Doo that I think is really funny and a lot of people may not know is Casey Kasem playing Shaggy.
Yes. I can hear it. As soon as you say it, I can hear it.
Yes. Right? When you say it, you can hear it, but it's such an unlikely sort of combination.
Really? Yeah. Casey.
They're like, really? But no, watch it. If you haven't seen it, watch it and listen. And
Casey.
Yeah. And he's, I don't know, in his own way, he was a...
Well, you know what? And I'll tell you what I liked about, Scooby-Doo was they were a team. They hung out together.
They were a team. They worked together.
They worked together, and I'm a real sucker for that. I'm
a lone wolf.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Is that why you were getting the super serum?
Yeah.
Oh okay, that makes a lot of sense. Right.
Anyway. Yep, we wrote these jokes in advance, folks. Okay, so we it's been such a crazy week in politics and so many big and weird revelations.
Off the rails.
And then we also just heard about another mass shooting, right?
Texas, yeah,
and
this church.
It's like, and so I think we're actually not going to talk about any of the big topics I'm posting on Facebook this week.
I'm not feeling it.
I'm not feeling it. I'm not ready to talk about Donna Brazile and all that revolution and whatnot and respond to my friends and not friends who are jumping all over it one way or the other, you know.
Yeah.
So I just don't feel ready. But I think we're going to do our segments. We're going to talk about what we've been reading and watching, mm-hmm. and that's going to be most of it.
Yeah.
And then
going to acknowledge our failure for walking this week.
Oh, we have to acknowledge our family, our failure.
Yeah, our family's not a failure, but our walk was this week.
Yeah. I do want to address two quick memes.
Oh, sure, two quick memes.
Go. So one thing I keep seeing in people's arguments about 2016
mm-hmm.
was how much more better qualified Hillary Clinton was than Sanders to be the president.
Yeah.
And I'm scratching my head about that. I just want to correct the record, TM, and point out that when you talk, they talk about how much more experience Clinton had than Sanders.
Yeah.
I just want to point out that Sanders has held elected offices of various types, of three elected mm-hmm. offices, for I think it's 32 years.
Yeah, but more than 30 years.
Yeah. And that includes a stint as mayor, 16 years as a representative,
yep.
and like 9 years as a senator.
Mm-hmm.
And
he's been in elected office a long time.
And he's also, even though he's an independent, he also has had some very significant committee memberships and appointments,
yeah,
including Veterans Affairs.
Yes.
And so I just want to point that out and saying his work in government has been consequential and long-standing.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah. And, you know, it's a record. He should not be entirely ashamed of his record.
No.
Really. I'm not pleased with his war record, but, you know,
yeah,
it's really hard to please me. You shouldn't listen to that.
Sure. Right? It is true also that he, as an independent, he is not, like, successfully sponsored and shepherded through a lot of bills on his own.
Right, right. And that's one of the failures of our two-party system.
Yeah.
Is it puts people in that position.
Yeah.
And it's hard to get anything through without the party apparatus to make it happen.
Right. So another thing I hear is also, and he's not even a Democrat, unlike Hillary Clinton, who is a lifelong Democrat. And I was like,
first, she was a Goldwater girl.
She was a Goldwater girl.
Sorry about this.
She worked on several Republican campaigns even through, even into college.
And I don't hold that against anybody. I worked on Republican campaigns.
Yeah.
It's not, you know.
So let's, it's not really a liability. You know, many people have changed parties.
Changed parties.
Party affiliations. But she was not a lifelong Democrat.
Nope.
So she did change, and why and how, that's, you know, yeah. You can read what happened to learn something about that, or maybe her other biographies or whatnot.
And form whatever opinion you have about it.
If you care, but...
But she's not a lifelong Democrat any more than Nelson Mandela is a nonviolent activist.
Right.
It's just an absurdity. It's rewriting history.
Yeah. So let's not say she was, you know, born a Democrat.
No.
And Sanders has not changed parties unless you want to say running on the Democratic ticket means he's given up the sort of being an independent, which... Since that's not really a party per se, how does that even...
What does that even mean? I mean, you can say whatever you want.
Yeah, you can say whatever you want.
Yeah, but that doesn't actually make sense.
I just want to address, and I have pushed back on people on Twitter saying, you can say these things, but these specific things you're saying, experience in politics and lifelong Democrat, they're not really true.
Yeah.
And... You know, it's true. Hillary was Secretary of State. She has 6 years as a senator.
Mm-hmm.
But First Lady is not an elected office.
No, it is not.
Secretary of State is also not an elected office.
That's 6 years in elected office.
Yeah, total.
Yeah.
All right. So for reading this week, you've got a long thing you're going to...
I'm going to read a thing. That's
you're
going to
read a thing.
That's like my what I'm reading thing.
So I'm going to mention I have some shorter bits to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
The first is, since finishing Elizabeth Warren's book, I have started reading Bernie Sanders, Our Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
First time I've ever read anything he's written.
Yeah.
Which seems lame, but...
And it's hard to read anything he's written without hearing it in his voice. That's the funny part.
I should say, just in terms of word count,
mm-hmm.
and sort of density of the story here, he's got Warren beat by a landslide. It's in smaller print, it's a denser font and all this. It's a lot of text.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that's cool is the photos in it are in the text.
Oh, that's nice.
So while you're reading along, there's a picture of,
whatever.
Whatever.
Yeah.
His voice is really, really genuine. His writing sounds in my head exactly like his voice
mm-hmm.
giving a talk.
Right.
It's sort of, and you say what you will, it just somehow to me, it sounds more authentic.
Yeah, no, he's got that authenticity thing down.
And, you know, he is a politician.
Yeah.
But I find it hard to believe that this is all a very calculated.
Oh, and I should clarify, as cynical as I am, and as much as my take on people as politicians, like, hey, it's a politician, do what politicians do.
Yeah.
I do appreciate Sanders' record.
Yeah.
I appreciate what he's tried to do in office.
Yeah.
I don't think he's calculated per se, as in, well, if I put in 4, I might get 6 out, and then
mm-hmm.
I might profit.
Right.
I think his calculation is much more about, well, then I'll be in a position to get something done.
Yes.
So I think he's making calculations, but his calculations are about how he can advance his service.
Yes.
And this is my take.
And you feel like you believe that.
Yeah, I believe that.
Yeah.
No, he's really... This is the only career where he's really been successful is in public service.
Right.
So, it's something that matters to him. He cares about it. And I think he's trying to do a good job.
Yeah. Warren is a good writer. By comparison, Sanders feels like a completely natural writer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I'm sure you almost have the sense that he didn't really edit.
Mm-hmm.
But he probably edited it.
I'm sure he edited it to some extent. Yeah, had someone look at it.
It's funny how little of himself he reveals
mm-hmm.
while it feels like she tries to do the opposite to humanize herself.
To be very revelatory, right.
And like the anecdote about her old dog dying.
Right.
At one point, Sanders mentions his mother dying,
mm-hmm.
but it's just like in an offhand passage about why he missed some event or something.
Right.
It wasn't, there wasn't a story behind it.
Right.
So he's not really self-revelatory, and he's not really building up like this
an emotional story about himself.
Right. He's building up a story about his career, you know, what he's been able to get done and not get done. And I'm only two chapters into it. The chapters are pretty dense.
Yeah.
But I'm enjoying it so far. So so I'll report back when I'm got a little further into it. I don't get as much time to read as I'd like to.
Fancy that.
Yeah. I took our oldest daughter, Veronica, to see Thor Ragnarok.
Ragnarok.
And I had, the only reason I picked that was basically that I kind of had blown a chance to take her to a movie that she wanted to go to. Mm-hmm. I was sick at home, and she was disappointed and whatnot. And so, like, you know what? Next, like, fun PG-13 action movie or whatnot, I'll see if I can take Veronica.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to say that this is part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe series, which apparently is like a 15-year plan to make, like, I don't know, 20 years.
Billions of dollars.
Yeah. It's just this giant money-making machine. And they're up to 17 movies. I didn't realize. I was just reading on Wikipedia. They're up to 17 films that are part of this cinematic, you know, universe. And
wow.
There's a team of writers, I guess, that collaborate across the films on these things.
It's good work if you can get it.
It's kind of amazing. So it is like, this is like filming a TV series, except scaled up times a thousand or a million.
Yeah. That's so freaky, but go on.
So of these movies, though, I want to point out that I have seen almost none of them. I have seen none of the Spider-Man movies, none of the Iron Man movies, none of the, you know, Captain America, none of the Avengers, none. They're all part of this big
movie franchise.
I haven't even seen Deadpool or Ant-Man, and those are probably the two I most am curious about.
Yeah.
But I couldn't really go see them with the kids because they're both pretty R-rated.
Pretty gruesome, yeah.
Yeah. I have seen Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
And that was a very entertaining movie.
It was a very entertaining movie. I regretted that we took the kids to it.
It was slightly more violent than we expected, and it actually kind of stunned and shocked Joshua by how violent it was.
Yeah. So, yeah, I enjoyed the movie. It was entertaining, but it was not something I would have taken the kids to if I had known quite what I was getting into.
We saw that in the theater. Mm-hmm. And then I've seen Doctor Strange. We saw Doctor Strange on DVD.
Fun. And again, a little more violent than I was really looking to get into.
It opens with a beheading.
Yeah, what's and with that? You know, so let's start with a beheading.
When we showed it to the kids, we just skipped that scene, honestly.
Yeah, good grief.
Anyway. So apparently, reading the reviews, Thor Ragnarok is the best of the Thor movies, which I guess is good that it's the one I see. My comment is also that even though it's part of this big structure and this big story arc and all these related interrelated characters and all that, it didn't feel like you really had to know anything about these other movies to enjoy it.
To enjoy it, right.
I mean, there's a lot of connections. There are probably a lot of callbacks that I would have noticed, but I was still very, very entertained. Right. So this is kind of my review. It's a really fun movie. Mm-hmm. It's very primary colors, day glow, gaudy. And the one thing that it did, I thought, really well was it would be easy to try and make a movie about Norse mythology that was ponderous.
All right, there's a lot there to go,
But that was very serious and ponderous and self, you know,
weighty,
aggrandizing and all this. Because, you know, you can just imagine everyone screaming, "For Valhalla, and, you know, to Asgard, we fight," you know, like on kinda the field like of battle, kind of like Tolkien. But this is something this film does really, really well. It's constantly puncturing its own seriousness.
Yes. Yeah. I got that from...
And this makes it much more entertaining to watch.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to shout out some performances. Christopher Hemsworth as Thor was really good. He's particularly good at, because Thor is slightly dumb.
Yeah.
He's like dumber than his dad and his brothers.
Mm-hmm.
He's not very good at scheming and planning. And so they're like thinking rings around him.
Mm-hmm.
But he's still very funny, you know. Yes. And he, again, doesn't take himself too seriously. And he doesn't, his sort of dumbness doesn't come off as, I don't know, offensive to dumb people, I guess, if that makes sense.
Well, no, I think you can do that where it's like, oh, we all know our limitations.
Yeah, he's an action hero. He spent most of his younger days smashing things with a giant hammer, right? That's kind of his go-to solution to everything.
He's got a hammer. Everything's a nail.
And then, the spoiler, this is sort of the big shift in the movie, is early on in the movie, his hammer is
destroyed.
Destroyed
his hammer?
And so he's really like,
what do I do now?
He's really a little baffled, like Thor without his hammer. It's like a day without sunshine. Right? You know? So, anyway. Tom Hiddleston plays Loki. He has a very odd and subtle performance as this guy who's keeps gaining Thor's trust again and then betraying him again.
But again.
And you keep expecting it, but you don't know when, you know, right. So... Cate Blanchett plays Hela, the goddess of death.
Yeah.
She's a pretty badass villain.
Yeah, no, she makes a great villain.
Totally cardboard and two-dimensional.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you don't get too deep into the motivation of why it is she's trying to kill everyone.
Burn it all. Burn it to the ground.
But she's really compelling on the screen, really evil-looking. Mm-hmm. Jeff Goldblum is kind of a surprise character. He plays Jeff Goldblum. he plays a character called the Grandmaster.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just, it's just the funniest role. It's the goofiest role.
He takes it and runs with it.
Tessa Thompson is a younger woman of color who plays the unnamed Valkyrie.
Oh, right.
And she's very good, too, because she doesn't just fall in love with Thor. It's a good role.
Right.
And she can put away the booze, man.
Well, you know, she's a Valkyrie. That's how it goes.
She's a Valkyrie who's drinking herself to death.
That's a lot of booze.
That's a lot of booze.
Yeah.
So she's a fun character. She's always pulling a knife on Thor, you know. It's like, where'd you pull that knife from? She's got like 20. So, let's see. Mark Ruffalo, I have not seen him previously do the Hulk/Bruce Banner.
Oh.
He's really, really good as Bruce Banner. And the scenes between, what's funny is so unheroic. He's like this nervous, weedy little guy who's like terrified and panicked and whatnot. And it's so not the Hulk,
right.
That it's a great contrast. And then he plays opposite Thor for a while. It's like a buddy picture, you know.
That's got to be fun.
Those scenes are hilarious. Rocket and I were just laughing. Anthony Hopkins plays Odin, and I didn't expect that. Mm-hmm. When I recognized him, I'm like, oh,
get out.
Yeah. He's not in for very long, sadly.
Aww.
The violence in the film is quite cartoonish. There is a lot of violence, though. Mm-hmm. So, you know, don't like take your 5-year-old.
It's not for your kindergartner.
Yeah. The effects are amazing for the most part. We've gotten kind of like jaded by amazing effects.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm always looking for, like, what's the effect that's really beyond the regular CGI, level of CGI that I'm looking at? And the one that I really loved was the fire demon Surtur.
Fire demons?
Because his face and mouth and everything as he's animated speaking were flaming, like we're on fire. It's kind of like the Balrog in Fellowship of the Ring.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Because he's like opening his mouth and you're like, you're looking in his mouth and inside of his mouth is on fire too. And you're like, how does that work? It was really visually amazing to see.
Amazing.
Surtur. Yeah. There's a brief scene with Benedict Cumberbund as Dr. Strange.
Snittle Swatch.
Snittle Swatch as Dr. Strange. And That's a fun scene. Yeah. It's directly connected to the movie we last watched.
Right.
So.
Yeah. The Doctor Strange movie. Yeah.
The whole thing has kind of a similar feel to Guardians of the Galaxy. Whenever there's a big fight scene, they start playing Led Zeppelin.
Right.
And then the hammer starts flying and the swords start flying. And yeah. So.
Yeah.
But it is a fun movie. It's fairly long, but they
want to see it now.
They keep it light and they keep it entertaining and it moves along well. There's a lot of sight gags, a lot of like character based jokes and whatnot. Mm-hmm. You know. So I enjoyed it. It's not a deep or profound art film that's not going to change your life, but
you'll have a good time.
We had a good time. It strikes me that it really would have made more sense as a summer blockbuster, but not quite sure why it was released in November.
Thanksgiving, I guess? I don't know.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Anyway, so those are my two things. I'm gonna insert a segment, if I'll listen to it, see how it sounds, that I recorded in our walk last week with a portable recorder.
Yeah,
we'll see if that came out okay. We'll put that in our walk section. So here we are.
Here we are.
At County Farm Park.
Yeah.
And this is
9 years later.
Is it 9 years later?
Yeah, we came here. Joshua was a couple days old.
I'm remembering various walks in County Farm Park, including one time when Veronica was about 4 years old.
Yeah.
And I brought her for a walk and I interviewed her along the way.
Yeah.
And I made a podcast of that.
Of that conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So tell us about County Farm Park.
I think it's my favorite park in Michigan. And I can't say that I've been to all of them all over the state.
No.
But I've been to many. And this one is just wonderfully designed. It has so many resources for so many parts of the community, for children, for adults, for elderly folks, singles, families, couples. It's a marvelous place. It's got a patch of woods, it's got prairie. Now, that said, I've enjoyed it for more than 20 years. They've made a lot of, quote, improvements over those 20 years. And some of those improvements haven't been improvements in my estimation.
Yeah.
A lot of trails have been paved that were not paved before. And people make the argument that that's for accessibility. You don't have to pave for accessibility. You don't. You need smaller and more
pea gravel or something.
Right, pea gravel, and it has to be packed firmer.
Yeah, I'm of course not having much experience piloting a wheelchair. I can't really say what.
Right. Right.
What's easier or hard to roll on, but this would definitely, what we're walking on now would definitely not be very.
No, we're not. This is not accessible. Soil's not accessible.
Yeah.
Leaf litter is not accessible. And less like large, loose gravel
rocks,
is not accessible.
You get just be sort of stuck or skidding around.
Right. Now, that said, I'm thrilled with, I want to say, about 60% of the so-called improvements.
Yeah. Well, what I'm noticing, and this place did have traffic noise, and in my old recordings, you can actually hear it.
You can hear some of the traffic noise.
In one of our walks, you can hear a stadium game.
Yes, from
in
a mile
background.
Away.
Yeah.
More than a mile away.
Yeah.
So, let's turn to the woods here, guys.
So,
Oh, this is okay. We know the way. We know the way.
Go this way. We've been here many times, guys.
Mm-hmm.
There is a fair amount of road noise, mm-hmm. and it's about a 4 o'clock maybe on a Sunday afternoon.
Yeah.
You wouldn't expect traffic to be this heavy, but Washtenaw County is just cutting.
Just swamped with people.
Denser and, you know, more and more packed with traffic.
Mm-hmm.
So, but here we are now.
Once we get into the thick of the woods.
We've taken just a few steps.
To turn into the woods.
Into the woods. And the traffic noise is decreasing dramatically.
Yes.
It's mostly noticeable when you're walking up right along the margin of the road.
Oh, we're waiting for you to check the map. Oh, go check the map.
Go check the map.
Yeah. Go ahead, check the map. We're waiting.
So how big is this park?
It's about 100, I think 110 acres.
Yeah, okay. So
actually, it's not that large.
No.
But it's also not that small either.
Right. You can get a decent walk, especially if you do a couple laps.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You can get a fully decent walk doing a couple, three laps.
Yeah.
You can take the dog out, you can get a nice brisk walk in doing one lap.
So that's kind of one thing that I wish we had been able to do. It just wasn't truly possible. But we did look at some properties for sale where we could have had 100 acres.
Yeah. You know? Oh, my goodness. Or even like just 20.
Or even 20. You know?
Yeah.
And with 20 acres, you can arrange, you can set up a trail that will give you a very effective
workout in 20 acres.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now we've got three, and we're trying to figure out, okay, what kind of a trail can we make through the woods in our backyard?
And how can we, you know, make that a space for physical recreation?
Where there's still woods, you know?
Yeah, yeah. So, we don't decimate the woods to play in the woods.
Right. Because we don't want to make it all tame and safe.
No, part of what's so beautiful is that it's not tame. It actually is fairly tame, but it's not a suburban backyard.
Yes. But I would like to be able to walk around the perimeter and maybe have a path that winds through it in some way.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, if we could put in a maze like the hedge maze in the
children's garden?
In the children's garden.
That would be marvelous.
At Mathai, that would be great.
Yes, yes.
I don't know what we can do along those lines. But a kid's play space, like if we had a little...
Just like that building area.
The building area with the little hut, mm-hmm. you know, with the, right. the little open frame house. The kids would probably spend
a lot of time
in there.
Mm-hmm.
It would be an important childhood building experience. Benjamin's having a rough day.
Oh, he is.
He's had a couple screaming meltdowns already.
Mm-hmm.
It was basically all we could do to get out.
Get out the door.
Get out the door today.
Mm-hmm. Afternoon.
I was up late finishing the production, post-production for the podcast.
Yeah.
And then we slept late and didn't really intend to, just kind of woke up so late.
And mostly rested, but not fully.
Yeah, and here we are.
Yeah.
And it's actually, today is Veronica's birthday.
And Joshua's birthday.
And Joshua's birthday. So, we are having, we're going to Mass, and then we're having a dinner, and they're going to have a little kids' party later.
Yeah.
It has been very hard to have like big birthday parties every
year. We have one big birthday party a year because we have some kids.
Yeah.
You get whatever you want on your birthday. And this is, I feel like no one seems to understand this in the family.
The dinner.
But
you get a meal.
Your dinner, your request, dinner and dessert on your birthday.
Yeah.
And then there's one party.
Right.
And everybody, all the kids can invite all the friends they want to invite for the party.
Yep.
And that's once a year.
It's a little confusing, too, because around this time of year, of course, people are going to Halloween parties and whatnot.
Right.
So, Rocket and Joshua are almost Halloween babies, literally.
Yeah, that's about.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
But it's fitting because our wedding was in October, and this is, if not our favorite month, it's close to it.
It's close. Yeah, no, it's my favorite month.
Yeah.
This is my favorite time of year.
Yep.
Every time I hear that song, it's the most wonderful time of the year. I think of this.
You think of October.
I think of October.
When you hear the Christmas song.
Yeah, I hear that song, I think of late October, early November.
We're now further into the woods. Can still hear road noise.
But I feel like you have to focus on it.
You have to focus on it, and
it's not
intrusive.
It's background noise.
Yeah, and the kids are running around. Two or three of them have been fighting us tooth and nail about getting in the car.
To go for the walks.
But yet...
We get there.
we get there, and when they get here, they're just playing.
Like,
they won't even stay on the trail. They run up the trail, back the trail. They're playing games.
Climbing on the rocks. And
they're being ninjas.
Et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
Right. They're all kinds of
play. So they're slowly learning that if I go, I'll actually have a good time, even right. though I have this significant inertia.
Well, basically, it's resistance to a transition.
Yeah.
Like, they don't want to make the transition.
Yeah.
Full stop. That's all.
Okay. So I'm going to... This is just a clip from one of our walks.
Yeah.
And I think we'll stick it in the Pottscast. So...
I think that'll be good.
And...
don't you, Ellie?
We've got a few more places to go around here that are not... Yeah. That are kid-friendly trails that aren't too challenging. So mm-hmm. we'll look for more. Bye-bye.
Later. Well, I know you're off the Texas hop. I know you're off the old fox trot. But when you do the walk, you ride in style. You just shake your hips and close your eyes. And then you walk. Yeah, you walk. And then you walk. And then you're going to talk about an article. Yeah, this is what I've read this week. And I loved it. It's an essay. A personal essay in, of all magazines, Bon Appétit, about Thanksgiving.
Yeah, this is not deeply political, except that it kind of is.
Okay, so I'm gonna read it to you because it's so enjoyable, and encourage you to please get a copy of Bon Appétit. This is a good essay, and then I'll talk a little bit more about it after I read it. Is that done?
Don't read the whole thing.
Don't read the whole thing.
That's not. I think that's a copyright.
Oh, is it a copyright violation? Okay, yeah. I will read an intro and an outro then.
Yeah, skip around. Find some segments you want to talk about.
So it's Thank You God for Black Thanksgiving, on Learning How to Be Black, One Family Thanksgiving in Atlanta at a Time, by Rembert Brown, November 1, 2017. I shouldn't even be talking about this, but here we are. First things first. Black people are not a monolith. It's reductive and a gross generalization to think in such terms. With that out of the way, let's talk about Black Thanksgiving.
as a reductive and monolithic thing.
The details of this event are admittedly sourced from my own Thanksgiving, a Black Southern celebration featuring four generations of people, dishes, and stories. It's the only Thanksgiving I can aptly speak of because I've only ever been to my own family's Thanksgiving, and my attendance record is 100%, 30 for 30. Which is appropriate because there should be a documentary about this glorious annual event that takes place in my mother's home in Atlanta.
That actually is kind of amazing, 30 years. I certainly didn't ever have 30 consistent years of Thanksgiving with my family before I was, you know, off away at college or traveling or whatever.
No, I mean, like, he went away to school and he went away. He comes back home for Thanksgiving every year. And it's a thing.
Yeah.
Right?
A lot of years it wasn't even clear who was going to host it, if anyone wanted to, you know.
Et cetera, right? Blackness often invites hyperbole, since we have to occasionally stretch the truth loudly simply to get acknowledged. The big Black Southern American Thanksgiving, however, it's near impossible to exaggerate what it's like to attend, to participate. That said, I've never described it well. I always post a photo of my annual first plate. Meatloaf and the turkey and the ham and the seven-layer salad and the macaroni
and cheese. Wait. Meatloaf, ham,
and turkey.
Three meats.
Three meats, seven salad, mac and cheese, two mac and cheese, broccoli casserole, yams, collards, cranberry sauce, dressing, rolls, giblet gravy. There's a lot of food.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot of food.
Right.
Well, I love a good assortment of sides, but I don't think I've ever had a Thanksgiving. Well, you know what? Aside from one Black Thanksgiving that I've been to, where there was more than one meat.
Yes. The food. Skipping ahead, the food and the cast of characters. These are the surface reasons for why it's hard to explain Wakandan Thanksgiving. But then there's the other reason. Blacksgiving is my blackest day of the year. And that is not something to take lightly. I typically have 6 to 8 extremely black days a month. To the untrained eye, the blackness is in the people. But that's not the entire story. The true essence is in the lens through which we discuss what has happened since we last came together. Now, if you've seen a movie, skipping ahead again, if you've seen a movie, there's all these tropes to expect. And sometimes that's how it goes at his mother's house.
Mm-hmm.
If Thanksgiving begins when it's supposed to, it's around 4 p.m.
As long as it's not a Madea film.
Yeah. But a lot of those tropes are even in the Madea films.
Yeah.
But what usually happens is someone gets there, usually the person that has a big chunk of the food gets there around 6.
Mm-hmm.
And then...
Yeah, describe the sound people's stomachs were making since they pretty much fasted since they got up.
Since they got up.
Because they knew they were going to... It was basically going to be a competitive eating thing.
Yes. So then you finally hear the honk in the driveway, a sign that a certain aunt, who will remain nameless because collard greens giveth, collard greens taketh away, has arrived with little intention of carrying the food inside by herself, because she is equal parts Cleopatra, Patti LaBelle, Nefertiti, and Tina Knowles. We waited because she is one of the primary forces in this family.
Tina Knowles is one of Destiny's Child?
I don't know who Tina Knowles is.
Is that Beyonce's sister? I don't know. Okay, anyway, just check.
Related to her being a primary force, she's got 20% of the food in her trunk. The men in the family, who can be counted on one hand, race out to get the food. Running out the kitchen, I get a kiss from my aunt as she walks through the door, only seconds away from Cyclops-level side-eye via her younger sister, known as my mom.
Cyclops-level.
You can feel the energy and the love and the sweat go around the circle. And then my uncle, revered man of the cloth, begins to speak. Thank you, God, for this food. Amen.
Everyone's pretty damn hungry at this point. Let's not beat around the bush.
Two sentences, 7 words. Perfect moment. And then skipping ahead. The quiet lasts for some time, but eventually we start talking again. The quiet after everyone digs into the food.
Yeah.
Which means we're back to the main question at hand.
All the chewing to it.
What do we talk about at Black Thanksgiving?
Good question.
In this era of Black Twitter, or the internet as a whole, a once guarded secret has come to the surface. The reality that Black people talk a certain way only around other Black people. One of the unearthed facts about this is Black people love making fun of white people, love griping about white people, love plotting an overthrow of America from white people as a form of reparations.
Oh my God.
That's all in the open now. There's nothing to see here.
Devastated.
have been startling for many white people. Secretly all liked it because the focal point was still white people. But Black Thanksgiving differs from every other day on the calendar.
Yeah.
It's the one day to forget white people exist. We only talk about Black people.
Well, that hardly seems fair.
The good, the bad, the
ugly. All people matter every day of the year.
Every day of the year. What? But we talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly. There's nothing like it. No one is safe. Religious figures and politicians? Not even close. Dead civil rights leaders and their family members? Not safe. No one. So while raucous and lively, the conversation is a calming exercise, comforting that some traditions still persist. And every single Thanksgiving is a blessing, but nothing has yet to touch 2008. To be fair, 2008 may have been the greatest Thanksgiving in Black history since 1865.
Do you want to say something about how excited your mom was to canvass for Obama?
Yeah, no. My mom canvassed for him. She rode around Saginaw, Michigan in her wheelchair.
Motorized wheelchair,
campaigning for him, literally going door to door with campaign information, stumping for Barack Obama in 2008, the entire year.
Mm-hmm.
I would sometimes call her and she'd be, oh gosh, I can't talk. I've got to get out of campaign. Or she'd be back in. She'd be coming back in from campaigning. And it was, I won't say all consuming, but she was all in.
Yeah.
She was all in for his campaign.
And it was inspiring to see, honestly, how important that was to her and that she got to see him win and become president.
Twice.
And we shouldn't.
Twice.
As many bad things as we have to say about how Obama actually governed, we should not entirely down his actual historic achievement.
Just the historic significance of his election.
Yeah.
And the significance of his election to the black community in the United States.
Yeah.
And I begrudge, and for anyone who knows me, you know, I really have nothing nice to say about Obama.
Right. About his actual politics.
About his politics, policies, about his presidency, yeah, about his administration. And, but that doesn't mean I have anything bad to say about my mom campaigning for him.
No.
I understand what she was doing and why, and I think it's wonderful. I think it's wonderful. And frankly, that only makes me angrier at Obama for being such a lousy president.
Yeah, for failing to live up to
her, failing her to live
faith,
up,
her trust.
To live up to her faith and trust in him as a candidate. But no, she really went to the mat for him in 2008. And really, I wouldn't say she single-handedly delivered the first ward of Saginaw, but I think she deserves some credit.
Definitely chipped in.
Yeah. Talk of the Obamas was the main event that year. Yeah. And to some degree, I'm skipping ahead again, Thanksgiving is the story of my family, but the way the day ends is the story of me. As a little boy, I'd run around, eat, do whatever I was told to do, and then try to stay up late, ultimately passing out on a sofa and waking up tucked in my bed the next morning.
You remember at the Thanksgiving that I went to with you to Milwaukee?
Yeah.
That's what happened to Isaac.
Yeah, he just passed out somewhere and someone tucked him in bed.
Well, everyone had gone off to bed and was up talking and he was falling asleep, and he actually just fell asleep in an armchair, and someone eventually put a blanket over him.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. And, you know, he goes through his teens and, you know, hides out instead of helping out.
Yeah.
And then he's up to his mid-20s and he's paying for himself to come home. And there's a little bit of, I don't have to be here, but I am, you know?
You know, I've got friends.
I got friends and stuff.
All right.
And this is, I think, a really great, I really want to read this paragraph here.
Yeah, it is.
This all led to last year's Thanksgiving. My cousin Aaron and I sat on my mother's couch, full, tired, shocked by a recent revelation. And as I stared down 30, and she looked at her new baby, we both realized this would be our family to run one day. Looking at me, as we both looked at our elders in the kitchen, she muttered, "We need to learn how to make this food." And it never hit me that this would one day be my food to help make, my family to help lead, the dishes, the stories, the history of our family. This was on us to learn and to perfect, starting today. As the room began to thin and the remaining family members fell asleep in various parts of the house, my mother walked into her living room. "You going anywhere?" she asked, looking at me. "I'll put it all away. Go to sleep," I said. Her smile was the one you give when you appreciate someone, even pretending to help. So it takes him 3 hours to put away the food.
Holland, what is it? She described as like a jigsaw puzzle of...
A Jenga
of Rubbermaid containers in the fridge. Trying to pack everything in.
Ate another full dinner in the process.
Yeah, just trying to... Oh, there's not enough room in this container. Oh, well.
Right. And then the closing paragraph. This is actually such a beautifully written essay. Yeah. You've got to go read this.
It is a beautiful essay.
You need to go read this. As I turned out the kitchen light, I was excited for her to wake up to see what her son had done, that her boy was slowly, slowly becoming a man.
I want to jump in and say it was only at this line in the essay that I realized the author was a man, because he had not been specific about it before and had specifically said a couple things about how there were six times as many women in his family as men and whatnot, and that only two men the author set you up to believe that this person who was talking about eventually taking over the traditional cooking for their family was probably a woman, right? And I'm like, yes. But you guessed at it earlier, but early go ahead on. Finish this paragraph.
But peeking into her room, I could see she already knew. After a day of stress and exhaustion, there was a small smile on her face as if she'd dozed off to the unfamiliar shuffle of my feet in the kitchen. I loved that smile. It assured me that she knew all the work was worth it, because our beautiful, complicated, formidable family had made it yet another year together, mm-hmm. as strong as ever. It's really great.
It's a beautiful essay.
You can find it online. It's Bon Appétit.
I'll put the link. We'll have in the
a
show link. Notes.
It's a beautiful essay. It's worth reading the whole thing for yourself.
Yeah.
But the thing that it evoked for me, of course, everything's political.
Why did you know immediately that it was a man writing?
There's a way that black men talk about their mothers.
It's very respectful and admiring.
Yeah. It's
and the just, women don't.
No, there's a certain rivalry.
Yeah.
That and like he says, it's a gross generalization.
Sure.
To just make a blanket statement like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, but if everyone you know is like this, it's not maybe right. It's not so gross.
Yeah. So I immediately picked up that this was a man talking about his mother.
That's interesting because I didn't notice that.
So yeah, well, there's always a certain kind of, you know, rivalry between black women and their mothers. And this isn't true for everyone. I know people have good relationships, et cetera. It's not what I'm trying to get at or to even talk about dysfunction. I want to highlight the fondness and the sort of cultural pattern of really respecting your mother mm-hmm. that you see from black mm-hmm. men. Yeah.
Because, you know, for fathers and sons, the struggle between fathers and sons is always a struggle to the death.
Yeah. I hear about that. I heard about that. But this is very political in this respect. You think about this. This is 30 years, three decades. This happens every year.
Mm-hmm.
These people reconnect with each other every year. And they aren't just random people. They're family.
Right.
And it's bigger than, so something I've talked about with you before, but I don't think I've mentioned here on the podcast before, is there's a pattern of voting a very nice car in the black community. And that's...
Like the 300s and...
Oh, yeah, like the crash of the 300s, which are beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or, you know, you have a Lincoln or you have this or you have that. You have a nice car.
Mm-hmm.
And that's about our financial industry setting it up so that the only nice thing blacks... people can purchase for themselves cars.
They can't take pride in their house and lawn in the way that white owners can.
Take pride in their house and their mortgage
market is largely closed to them because of many different factors. Yeah. But
layers of factors.
Largely historic racism in the market.
Right, in the housing market means that sort of sense of pride of ownership that people, most Americans have in their home, a lot of black Americans have in their car, right?
And their home is... Not
is a rental,
yeah,
or whatnot. And I know nothing about the author's family specifics,
sure,
or anything, but the reality is this took place year after year, regardless of what else was going on. This happened,
mm-hmm.
and he came home for this. I think it's also important to point out that this happened in Atlanta, where there is a large
There's a black middle class.
It's a huge black middle class in Atlanta, and it's a force for politics and for what happens in Atlanta.
Right, which is why Trump has to denigrate Atlanta as a hellhole.
Of course, right?
Yeah.
And that's the environment, the backdrop where this happens, where there's this sort of cradle of a black community for a black family to thrive.
Mm-hmm.
And you said yourself, you know... You didn't make 30 consecutive Thanksgivings in a row.
No, it was not. By the time I was in college, my stepfather was suffering from, you know, dementia and mm-hmm. family moved away, and it just was very difficult.
Very fractured.
To get fractured. And on my family, it was fractured from my childhood.
For a long time.
Yeah. Right. So, yeah.
But here's the thing that I think is really interesting. It's in some ways foreign to a lot of Americans to imagine that you have a family tradition you've engaged in for 30 years.
It is foreign to me.
I think it's foreign for a number of Americans.
Yeah.
And for some Americans, it's familiar that you've got a family tradition that you've engaged in for 30 years.
My tradition now that I've tried to engage in around Thanksgiving, and I hope always to be able to, mm-hmm. if there are any strays, I mean, I say that affectionately,
mm-hmm.
anyone who does not have a family to go to and would like one,
you know, can come with us.
Coworkers and students, you mm-hmm. know, anyone we know who's around, we always try to open up our home for that.
Yes.
So, and we've got a friend, one of my coworkers is coming.
Yeah.
Who doesn't have family in the area. Mm-hmm. So, and he's been over for dinner before. He knows us, knows right. how weird we are.
He knows what he's getting into.
Yeah. But so, that's the best I've got as far as the tradition.
Right. And it's such, it is such tradition for this author and yeah. for many in the yeah. Black community that somebody has to learn the recipes and take it over.
Yes, they actually feel that responsibility.
They feel that responsibility and the weight of it, and that yeah. it's theirs.
And that it's serious.
It's serious, it's theirs, and that it's much a gift as a responsibility.
But it's not just the one guy, right?
Right, no, there's so
it's
many.
It's not going to be his alone. He's talking right. about how this is a community effort.
I mean, if his cousin's going to be there. A couple of the
people coming into adulthood, to their serious adulthood,
right.
are like, yeah, it's up to us.
It's up to us now.
Yeah.
Yes, and that it's as much gift as it is responsibility.
Yeah. Yeah, that's actually why it's the essay is more moving, because if it didn't include a sensation of things passing away and the passage of time, then right. it's kitsch and not.
It's just kitsch.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
And for me, I think that people are always like, so distributism, what the hell is that? It doesn't even make sense. I've never heard of that before, et cetera. And there are all these sort of things, you know, there are articles you can search and find. It's their YouTube videos explaining distributism in 100 seconds or something stupid like
that. Yeah, while standing on one foot.
Or yeah, whatever, right? I actually
That's
feel...
That's an Ayn Rand reference, by the way.
I actually feel like this right here is the most poignant definition of distributism that I've ever experienced. And it's very metaphorical. I hope you can hang with me for it. The idea is that distributism distributes power and resources as widely across the populace as possible, so that every family has the means of producing their own wealth and their own safety in the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
This essay really captures why that's valuable. Huh. What it means to have yeah. a family to care for you and keep you in the world.
And also, yeah, that is resilient across
decades.
Across decades, yeah.
The resilience that's built into that and the cocoon that provides for a person to return to for strength and renewal.
And it's not about individual success in your
no.
career.
It is not. It's almost as it's completely. That's beside the point.
Yeah.
The success.
No, I was just reading. Last week we talked about this National Review article and then the rebuttal to it.
Yeah.
And I was reading the National Review article and just again
really
paying
close.
Attention to how crass and obnoxious it was and
it's disgusting
how much it again pins blame on individual success and failure, you know,
right.
Pins blame on individuals for their poverty, for their failures, right. for their destruction of their families.
And we don't know about this man's family, how well they've succeeded
no.
or failed,
no.
how wealthy or how poor or anything about them.
But it's not a story about how he now has a job at Google, and so he came home and was able to pay for Thanksgiving.
No.
You know, it's his whole family.
This is what his whole family does together.
Yeah.
And it's a touch point during the year. And what I think is nice about Thanksgiving, there's a lot of things I think aren't nice about Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
Don't misunderstand me.
Yeah.
But what I think is nice about
Plymouth
Thanksgiving.
Rock landed on us.
No. For example. is
not
that it is
me, but.
Truly American.
Yes.
As in the American continent. And
yeah, it's not just a rehash of someone else's cultural
someone else's
tradition.
Cultural thing, right?
Yeah.
And especially now, centuries on, it's not a rehash, it's its own
right.
thing. It's become its own thing.
Yeah.
And it's something we all share as Americans. It's not religious.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean,
mostly not political.
The way people watch football, you can't say that's not a religious.
Yeah, no, that's. I think that's another story for another day. It's a it is a secular religious.
Talk
ritual.
About taking the knee. I mean,
yeah, no joke. But it's not explicitly religious. It's not political. it's really a place that it's just about ritual and family.
And macaroni and cheese.
Macaroni and cheese, yeah. Well, I think... I've never served macaroni and cheese at Thanksgiving. But I do make that sweet potato casserole that you like so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, there's the... That's the thing. The dishes that I remember so fondly from my childhood, which included... like the candied sweet potatoes with marshmallows on top and various forms of Jell-O salad, you know, like fluffy Jell-O salad. I can't eat those anymore, honestly. They just make me sick.
As much as you love them.
Yeah. There's I've changed. It's not them, it's me.
It's me.
Yeah.
So I think if you really want to understand this thing that people who, and I think, a friend of mine likes to describe distributism as a form of anarchy, and I think that's fair.
Mm-hmm.
What people are talking about, this is what we're talking about, where a family has the resilience to be there for each other for 30 years, for 50 years, for a century.
Yeah.
It's the thing that you, it's the thing you feel inside you, at least here, when you drive by these farms. Michigan has century farms.
Oh,
they've been owned by the same family for more than 100 years.
Yeah.
And it's the feeling you feel inside when you see that sign on a farm and you think, wow, that's something. And it's much more about that. I
wonder if they'd invite me in for breakfast.
Yeah.
For scrambled eggs.
Scrambled eggs.
And toast and coffee. I wouldn't even behead them.
Right?
Yeah.
How cool would that be? So I think the real heart and soul of anarchy, the real heart and soul of distributism, or whatever words you want to use to describe this decentralist bent. That's the heart and soul of it. It's families that are resilient and loving and supportive and there for each other for the long term. We're not talking about anybody's career success. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about somebody making a pile of money.
Yeah, buying his mom a pink Cadillac.
It's not about that. It's about enduring and being there for each other and being a framework for each other for the long haul. And it's hard for me to have a vision of society that would be better than that.
Yeah, it's kind of wistful for me, because there were years when my family was all getting together for Thanksgiving.
Yeah,
but it was not, they were people we only saw twice a year. And and didn't really get along that well.
Even this twice a year, right?
Yeah, and the table debates were all about politics.
We're tepid.
Yeah, tepid, and watch TV afterwards. Yeah, but I do have some really great memories of Thanksgiving get-togethers. Most of them are just like, hey, I got to chat with my mom in the kitchen while we were cooking.
Yeah.
You know, not the meal, not the conversation at the meal or whatnot, but I got, but like the little side conversations and interactions, especially the years that I did actually get home from school or after, where it was, we realized that it was not.
Well, you know.
That it was rare.
I've got to say, though, and this is not me really saying much more about Atlanta other than what a great middle-class black community it is, where there's a thriving black community.
People could live there and have careers and jobs.
Careers and jobs over for the long term.
And thrive in the long term.
Right.
Yeah, we talked about this before, it wasn't entirely my choice to leave my hometown. Everyone pushed me out, honestly. Everyone said, you got to get out of here.
You don't necessarily get pushed out. I mean, you might end up having a job wherever.
Sure.
But it's the kind of place where you could make a life, you know?
Yeah.
And I would posit that...
That's part of traditional communities.
Right.
That really doesn't exist.
No, it doesn't exist very much. And that's not actually an accident. That's a neoliberalism. Neoliberalist...
Individualism. Everyone's got to go make a career, and you go where the money is.
Yeah, that's not actually.
And you have to.
That's not really a choice in the matter.
That's part of the National Review solution to poverty. Is if they just made better choices, like go to you know,
following the money, go to school, go do to, the thing,
go become a web developer
or whatever.
Yeah.
And so these experiences that you had, and frankly that I had, where
your family was also fractured in its own way.
Where, you know, all of us grew up and went off to our jobs.
And that Thanksgiving I mentioned in Milwaukee, that was an unusual trip. That was a special.
Yeah, that wasn't yearly for us.
No,
right?
No, that was a one-off.
And that's something that's neoliberalism's gift to us.
Yeah, that keeps on giving.
Keeps on giving, is that this sort of fracture right down to our families and our ability to be there for each other. And even this way, to one day a year be there for each other.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it cuts us to the bone. And it's not an accident.
Yeah.
Because now we are filled and nourished by Black Friday. You know? We are filled and nourished by our things.
You mean National Buy jobs. Nothing Day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're not buying anything that day, just to be clear.
Yeah.
So it got me all in the feels, right? You know, this
that's
story
good.
Got me all in
the
feels. But also I could see why my political convictions matter to me.
Mm-hmm.
This is why it matters. This is why it's
this
important.
This is the difference between a neoliberal world and a conservative world.
Yes.
Or a distributist world.
Really, this is the heart of conservatism, if there is any American conservatism,
yes.
That you are with your family at least one day a year, every year.
Yeah.
Everything else happens, and that happens, but you come home every year.
Right.
This is why my political convictions matter. This is what I'm about.
Okay.
And, yeah.
Thank you for sharing that essay.
My pleasure.
I will put it in the show notes.
Excellent. Yes, my pleasure.
And, you know, again, this week we've got too many political topics to pick one.
Can't even. Yeah.
But we'll do something else next week.
Yeah, we will. Oh, we did get a little list of, it's not something for public consumption, but we got a letter and it was very encouraging and we appreciate hearing from our listeners every week.
Cool.
Yeah. Vija from out on the West Coast sent me a note and I really appreciate her encouragement.
Oh, great. Glad to hear it. Okay, everyone. We're going to wind up.
Yeah, that's about that.
Imagine whatever music I pick to put in right about now.
Woo-hoo.
And thanks for listening, everyone.
Thanks for listening. Have a good week.
Bye-bye. Riding this morning.